Connect.
Well, good morning, everybody. Hey, how's it going? As you can tell, we're running a little bit behind today, but that's nothing new. We're experiencing some technical difficulties, but we're excited that you're here. Are you excited that it's Palm Sunday? Anybody excited in the house? Yeah. All seven of us, good job. Hey, we're so excited, and we're just looking forward to today's service. As we begin, let's start with a word of prayer. We're going to pray that all of our stuff works today and that we'll be able to make sure this sermon goes well. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes as we pray to the Lord. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for today. I thank you for everybody who's watching us online. I pray that you would continue to keep us safe and to help us to trust in you during this time. I thank you that we can remember Jesus on the last week of his life as he heads towards the cross. I pray that you would help us to always remember your goodness and your grace. And today, as we worship you, we pray that you would be honored by it, that you would receive glory from it. And Lord, that everybody who's watching us online would receive a blessing today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you.
We find strength to face the day.
Father, we just thank you right now. And we come in your name. Nothing can stop you, Lord. When things need to happen, they will happen because it is in your name that we come and we call out to you this morning. For there is no power of evil that can stand against you. And we thank you for all that you have done and all that you're about to do. Pastor Abel, for continuously letting us know about you and your love and reminding us who you are, Lord. We thank you, we honor you. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning again. If you have your Bible, would you turn with me to Luke, the 19th chapter? Luke chapter 19, we're going to be looking at the story of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Hey, I just wanted to remind you that today we are doing the Lord's Supper right after the sermon. And so I want to encourage you, start during some boring part of the message, to prepare now. You know, grab some bread or crackers or whatever you might have at home, some juice or something else. You want to get that ready for right after the message today. In Luke chapter 19, we are looking at the story of that very first Palm Sunday. Now, it's interesting because in the scripture, the Bible tells us that this is a very pivotal moment in history. Jesus is drawing closer to the cross. We remember that he is going to be crucified in 5 days on that Good Friday. And we also remember that in 3 days, he's going to be rising from the grave. Now, here we are 2,000 years later. We can look back and we know that, but those people right then and there, they had no idea. And yet, the scripture actually foretold what was going to happen on that very first Palm Sunday. In Zechariah 9:9, if you can look up here on the screen, hopefully you'll be able to see it. Zechariah prophesied 500 years before it ever happened. He says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, and shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." And so it's in this prophecy that we find the sequence of events that are about to unfold. In Luke chapter 19, verse 28, we'll notice this as I read it. Take a look up here on the screen or on your Bible. The scripture says, "After Jesus had said this, he went on up ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And as he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, 'Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt that tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. And if anyone asks you, why are you untying it, tell them the Lord needs it.'" Now, it's interesting because Jesus had to have set this up ahead of time. They're not just going to go and steal somebody's donkey, right? He says, "Go and find it. And when they come out and they ask you, what are you doing? Tell them that the Lord needs it." And so they said, go ahead and take it. In verse 32, it says, "Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying, they asked him, 'Why are you doing this?' And he replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, and they threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. And as he went along," notice this, "people were spreading their cloaks on the road. And when he had came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.'" They tell him, "Why are you allowing them to say this? You're not the Messiah." They didn't believe he was. "And so why are you allowing them to talk to you like this?" Jesus replied, "I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." I love that. In Luke chapter 19, verse 41, drop down a little. It says this: "As Jesus approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it, and he said, 'If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you.'" It's an amazing sight. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem, and the crowd is crying, "Hosanna," which means save us. And they're cheering for Jesus, and they just want to see the Savior come by. The scripture says they took off their jackets and they put it on the road so the donkey could walk right over it. You know what else they did? They cut palm branches off and they started waving them at him. That's why we call it Palm Sunday, is because of what they were doing that day. It was this incredible event, this ticker tape parade that they gave to Jesus. But you know what's incredible about this? While all these people came out to see Jesus, not everybody showed up that day. Can you imagine this big old parade going down the street? And some people were like, that's just Jesus. I don't need to go and see Jesus. I don't need Jesus. It's interesting because this is also how it is today with you and I. Whenever we get a glimpse of God, we have a choice. Are we going to do it God's way, or are we going to do it our way? And the same was true back then. There were people who were excited to see Jesus. They welcomed Jesus. And there were others that were just too busy to come and meet the Messiah that day. As we look at today's message, the title of my message is called Glimpses of God. I want to look at some times in our life that you and I might actually see God working. That we might see Him not only working in our lives, but in the lives of others. And so I want to encourage you, maybe you have a piece of paper and a pen. Let me encourage you to take some notes today. If you haven't already, hit the share button so that people can watch our service right now as we move forward in it. Are we going to follow God's path or not? Are we going to honor Him or are we just going to ignore Him? Are we going to do what He says, or are we just going to do what we want to do with our own lives? That is the choice that we have been given today. The scripture says, as Jesus entered into the town, He was seen weeping. He was crying over the town of Jerusalem. And I think one of the reasons He may have been crying, guys, is because He realized that even though He came for everybody, He knew that some people would say no to Him. That some people would choose their own path instead of the one that God has for them. And I just want to encourage you today, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, I want you to get a glimpse of Him today. And then I want to encourage you, at the end of this message, I'm going to lead you in a prayer inviting Jesus Christ into your life. I want to challenge you to think about it as we go through it, and then to do that at the end. Now, I'm going to give you five things. Five things that we can look at today. When am I most likely to get a glimpse of God? When am I most likely to have that happen? Number one is this. When I realize how fragile life really is. And you want to write that down. It's up here on the screen. When I realize how fragile that life really is. When we realize that this life doesn't last forever. You know, as we're looking around on the news and as we're hearing these reports about this coronavirus, it can be a very scary time. Would you agree with that? It can be a time where we realize, wow, this could happen to me, or this could happen to somebody I love. And we start to worry and we start to panic about it. But I just want to say this, even in the midst of trials, even in the midst of this virus, even in the middle of anything that could go wrong in our lives, that you can still see God working there. That God loves you and He's concerned about every aspect of your life. And He is there. And I just want to say this. If you open your eyes to God, you will see Him working even in this time. Now, I'm going to read to you this passage in Isaiah. Isaiah 43 verse 1 through 3. You might want to write that down. In Isaiah 43, 1 through 3, God gives us this promise, and He says this, "Don't be afraid, because I have saved you." Now, I just want to say this, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you have nothing to be afraid of. Why? Because He promises us that He will be with us. That doesn't mean that you're not going to be affected by what's happening in the world. That doesn't mean that you may never get sick or I never have a problem. What that means is that God will be with us no matter what happens in our life. Now the scripture goes on to say, "I have called you by name and you are mine," God is saying. When you pass through the waters, you go through difficult times in your life, I will be with you. When you cross over the rivers, you will not drown. When you walk through fire, you will not be burned, nor will the flames hurt you. This is because I, the Lord, am your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Your Savior. Now, I just want to ask you, is He your Savior today? Is He somebody that you've put your trust in today? Would you desire to go down your own road, or do you desire to come and look and see what God has for you in your life? There was this man who thought he had it all together. He was very wealthy, and he thought, I'm just going to do my own thing. But I want you to notice this story. It comes from Luke chapter 12. The apostle Luke wrote this, and he says this, Jesus told them a story. He says, there was a rich man who had some land, and which he grew a crop on. And he thought to himself, what will I do? I have no place to keep my crops. And then he said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to tear down my barns and I'm going to build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and all my other goods. Jesus is telling this story and he's like, you know, there's people out there in the world who all they want is to accumulate more and more and more and more. And when I run out, I want to tear down what I have so I can build something greater than what I had before. This is what the man said. He says, then I can say to myself, I have enough good things stored to last for many years. Now I can rest, eat, drink, and enjoy my life. That's it. I've arrived. I've got everything I want. Now I'm just going to enjoy my life. But I want you to notice this. But God said to that man, you foolish man, tonight your life will be taken from you. So who will get the things you have prepared for yourself? Who's going to get it when we're gone? No, somebody, a kid or somebody's going to get that. The government might even take your stuff away. But I just want you to get this. When we put our trust in God, when we realize how fragile life is, we know that He will be with us no matter what. Now, I want to give you three reasons why you don't want to put off waiting for God. Number one is this. You and I don't know how long we have left. Isn't that true? We don't know how long we have on this earth. And so we don't want to put off knowing the God who created us. Number two is this. We can never replace the time that we missed with God. You know, some people, when they're younger, they follow God. And then as they get older, they move away from God. And then later on in their life, they come back to God. But I just want you to think about this. They have wasted all of these years. And you can never get those back. So you don't want to do that. And number three is this. We can depend on God to help us in every area of our life. And for that, I just say it's a great reason to put your trust in Jesus today. Let me give you the second thing to write down. Another time where we might get a glimpse of God is this. When I run up against a season of testing. When I run up against a season of testing. Now, I just want to ask you a question. Would you agree that we're going through a storm right now as far as our world is concerned? All over the world, people are panicking. We heard today that this virus in the United States is going to escalate in the next 2 weeks. There are people that we are starting to know personally who are thinking that they may be sick and may have this, and we are going up against a season of testing right here and right now. The reality is, though, whenever we go through a season of testing, we do not always turn to God for comfort. The truth is, we can turn to a lot of different things. Some people will just say, you know what, I don't need God, I'll just go through this myself. And they do, and they go through it themselves, but they don't have to. Other people, when they go up against a season of testing, they rely on other things like drugs or alcohol to deaden the pain or to take it away. And then some people, instead of asking God for help, you know what they do? They blame God. And they get mad at God. And they say, God, it's your fault. But the reality is, God desires to be with us in these seasons of testing. The scripture says that God never tests us. Did you know that? That He does allow the test to come, but He is not the one who's doing it. James, the brother of Jesus, writes this in James chapter 1, verse 13 through 15. He writes, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desire, he is dragged away and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. The scripture says that God doesn't test us. God doesn't do that. He allows the test, but He doesn't bring it. And here's the thing about that. Because God doesn't bring it, He can help bring you through it. He can help bring you through it. So no matter what's going on in the world right now, it's important to remember that God will bring us through it. I love this verse in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. The apostle Matthew is writing, and he's quoting Jesus when Jesus says, "Hey guys, come to me. All of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." I love that. Jesus says, don't run from me. Come to me, and I will give you rest. I will give you peace. I'll give you comfort, even in the midst of trials. Now, Romans 8:35 says this, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Notice this. Shall trouble or hardship or danger?" How about a virus? Can that ever separate you from the love of Christ? No way. Look at what he says. "No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." Jesus Christ loved us, and we're more than conquerors. We can get through this. We're going to get through it here, or we're going to get through it in heaven, but God will see through it, see to it that he will walk with us the whole way. Now, number three, you want to write this down. Another time when you might see God is this: when you require more than just the status quo. When you require, and I require, more than just the status quo. Now, there's an interesting thing happening in our world today. Because of social distancing, because of works, job situations closing down, and we're seeing all these people at home these days, and they're doing these funny videos, or they're just posting stuff on their Facebook page. An interesting thing is happening, guys. You and I are getting to rest and to spend time with those that we love the most. Now, here's the deal. We want to go back to work. I get that. But I want to encourage you to see this as an opportunity to strengthen your life, to strengthen your family, to get the rest that you've needed. We all have an opportunity now to find rest. And I just want you to think about this. When this thing is over and we get to go back to work, I mentioned this before in another message, you and I have to decide, are we going to just go back the way it's always been, or are we going to make some adjustments in our life? The scripture says that God desires to work in our lives. He will be with us. One of the things I want to challenge you to do as you're working on your life at home during this time is to ask God to show you some areas that you can strengthen. I want you to notice this passage in Psalm 139. The psalmist writes, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me into the way of everlasting." When we see how great God is, when we get a glimpse of him, we look at our lives and we say, "God, I want something more than just what I have. I want something greater, something more than what I've been given. I want to follow you. I want to know you more." And the scripture says, God created you for a reason. He created you for a purpose. And the only way you get to know that is to get to know him. Why? Because he's the one who created us. I love this prayer. It's called the Prayer of Jabez in 1 Chronicles. Jabez was this man who asked God to do something pretty incredible in his life. I want to encourage you to think about the prayer. And I just want to encourage you to maybe pray something like this. Look at what he said. "Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. His mother had named him Jabez, saying, 'I give birth to him in pain.'" Can you imagine that being your name, a pain? Some of you are a pain. But Jabez, his mother named him pain because she gave birth through pain. Now notice this. "Jabez cried out to the God of Israel, 'Oh, that you would bless me, and that you would enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm, so that I will be free from pain.'" And you know what the scripture says? God granted his request. He asked, "God, bless me." That's an okay prayer to pray. "God, watch over my family." That's not a selfish thing. "God, bless me." But also, "God, bless those other people as well," right? Watch over them. Enlarge my territory. Help me to do something greater than I could ever imagine, God, for you. Let your hand be with me. Keep me from harm. And I just want to encourage you to pray that, Lord, keep me from harm. Keep our loved ones from harm. The scripture tells us that God desires to hear us pray. And so I just want to encourage you, as you're home, as you're thinking about your life, to ask God to show you what does he want to do in your life? What is he trying to teach you during this time? Let me go to the next point. Number four, the next area that we might get a glimpse of God is this. When I recall the lives of others, when I think about other people in this world. I don't know about you, but when I became a follower of Jesus Christ, I'm one of those people that I need to see it in order to believe it. Maybe you're like me. You have to see it in order to believe it. I had known about God. I grew up hearing about God. But as I got older, the reality is I wanted nothing to do with God. The people in our lives that are making a difference, those people who come into your life and tell you about God's love, those are the people I want you to think about at this time. You know, for me, when I was 13 years old, there was another friend of mine who was 13 years old. His name was Ben Giacero. Some of you might know that if you're watching this. You might know that person. But this guy told me about God. He invited me to church. And after I said, no way, I don't want anything to do with that, he kept after me and after me. So one day I said, sure, yeah, I'll go. And when I went, I heard how much God loves me. I heard how much he desires a relationship with me. And I just want you to know that a 13-year-old made a difference in my life. I want you to notice this person up here on the screen. Her name is Angie. She's a friend of a friend. She's a respiratory therapist. And she and her friend, this last week, they flew to New York City in order to help those who are sick with this coronavirus. Now, I just want you to think about this. This person put her life on the line to go and help somebody else. She put her life on the line to go and help somebody else. When I think about people who have made a difference in the world, I think about my friend Benji, I think about this woman named Angie, and I think about all those other people who had an influence in my life to find God and to know him better. I just want to ask you, who is that person for you? It could be your mom. It could be a grandparent. It could be a friend. Don't ignore those people. God put those people in your life so that you can know him. And so I just want to challenge you to focus on that. Let God show you who he is through these people. Hebrews 12:1 says this, we have such a huge crowd of men and women of faith watching us from the grandstands, people who are watching our lives. So we should strip off anything that slows us down and holds us back, especially the sin that wraps himself so tightly around our feet, trying to trip us up. Let us run with patience and the particular race that God has set before us. I love that. The scripture says we should keep going forward. There are people watching us, and there are people watching us during this time of this virus and what's going on in the world. And how you respond to God is going to be an impact upon how they respond to God because they're watching you. The scripture says in Acts that many people came to know the Lord because of their witness, because of who they were. So I just want to challenge you to be a witness, to continue to share your faith, and to be the example God's called you to be. Now, let me give you one last one. The final way that I get a glimpse of God is this. When I respond to a simple message. When I respond to a simple message. Let's just be honest. This was a simple message. Hopefully it wasn't too painful. But when you and I respond to God, that's when our relationship with him grows. It's how we learn about him. When we hear his word, when we read his word, when we listen to his word, we get a glimpse of God. And I just don't want you to hear this message. I want you to respond to it today. I want you to do something. I want you to choose God rather than to continue to live for yourself. The reality is this, guys, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We do know that this virus is about to get worse. And so I'm praying for you. Please pray for me and all those who are here today who are doing this service for you. I want to encourage you to remember who God is during this time. Did you know that the Bible says this? The whole Bible was given to us by inspiration from God. It is useful to teach us what is true, make us realize what is wrong in our lives, and it straightens us out and helps us to do what is right. You know, in Revelation, the scripture says this. Jesus tells people this over and over and over again. He who has an ear, let him hear. And you know what that means? It means pay attention. If you can hear this message, pay attention. Pay attention to what we've said about God and His love for you and how this week we remember His sacrifice for us on the cross. Jesus reached out His arms with nail-pierced hands and He said, I love you. I love you enough to die for your sins and for mine on the cross. Let me leave you with this last verse. Romans 10, 9 and 11 says this. The Apostle Paul writes, whoever believes in Him will not be disappointed. I love that verse. Whoever believes in Him will not be disappointed. Whoever. I love that. It doesn't matter who you are, what you've done, what your background is. God loves you. He forgives us of our sins. He gives us a new purpose for life. He gives us a home in heaven. And you know what the scripture says? You'll never be disappointed with that. And I just want to say, I've been a Christian for many, many years now. I've never been disappointed with God. I've disappointed Him a number of times, but I've never been disappointed with God. Today, I just want to invite you to make a choice. Like those people were there at the beginning, when some people welcomed Jesus into the town, other people ignored Him. Don't be that person today. If you need a relationship with Jesus Christ, right now is when you're going to do that. You're going to ask Him into your life. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Let me lead you in a prayer this morning. You know, maybe today for the first day in your life, you might have got a glimpse of God. And I just want to encourage you, don't just ignore that. Be willing to give your life to Him today. If you want to ask Jesus into your life, it's simple. Just say something like this. Jesus, I don't know everything about You, but I know that You love me. God, You love me. And so I ask You to come into my life. Forgive me for doing life on my own. Help me to stop doing that and help me to trust in You. I thank You that You went to a cross for us, that You stretched out Your arms to show us how much You love us, and that You died for our sins on the cross. Jesus, thank You for forgiving me. Help me to live for You because You died for me. Help me to live and be an example for others. From this day forward, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Now I just want to say this, guys. If you prayed that prayer, do me a favor. Message me. Message us here at Faith Fellowship. I'd love to hear how God is working in your life. This morning, we're going to do something pretty special. It's called the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is one of those things that maybe many of you are familiar with, or maybe you're not very familiar with it. You need, if you want to do this with us, if you just prayed that prayer for the first time, you're welcome to do this. This is one of those things that are for believers, people who actually trust in God. It doesn't make any sense to do this if you don't really believe in God. But you can look at this and you can say, okay, what does this mean? Because I want to tell you what it means. You know, it's a very simple act. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took some bread. He took some bread and He broke it and He passed it out to His disciples. And He told them, this is a reminder. He says, when He had given thanks, He broke the bread and He said, this is My body, which is for you. Eat it in remembrance of Me. We're not going to eat it just yet, but I just want you to remember this, that Jesus died for you. And so every time we do this at church or even at your home today, we remember how much He loves us. And And we remember that his body was broken and put on a cross for us. It's a symbol also because it represents his body and his blood. In the same way he took the cup, is saying, this cup of the new covenant is in my blood. Drink it to remember me. And so we remember him and what he did when we take this. His body was broken and his blood was spilled so that you and I could have eternal life in him. It's a statement of faith as well, because this, for whenever you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes back. We as followers of Jesus Christ, we believe that Jesus is going to come back one day. Why? Because he said he was. And so we believe it. We put our trust in him and we just say, God, whenever you're ready, you come back. So today, guys, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at our lives and we're going to say, God, is there anything in our lives that we need to change or address? Lord, help us to do that. God, I confess a sin that I might have been doing. Help me to change, Lord. I pray that you would help me recommit my life to you. Help me to follow you again. Maybe you've walked away from God and today you asked him back into your life. And I just want to encourage you, keep moving forward. You're going to mess up. Everybody messes up. But when you do, get up. Keep short accounts with God. Ask him to forgive you. And then keep going forward. And then finally, the scripture says, if there's a relationship that we need to work on, if there's a broken relationship, let's do that together. Let's work on those relationships so that we can honor God. The Apostle Paul, he writes in 1 Corinthians, and we're about to take this Lord's Supper together. He says, for I received from the Lord, which I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's take this together, guys. God for what he's done in your life right now. The scripture goes on to say, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's take this together. Let me close with a word of prayer, and then I got a couple announcements, and then we'll be done with our service. We hope you enjoyed it today. We love you, and we want you to know that God loves you, and that he's going to do a great thing in your life as you follow him. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, I thank you so much that we can take the Lord's Supper today, and we can remember how much you love us. God, we want to see it to believe it. So when we want to know how much you love us, help us to look at the cross. That you loved us so much that you died for our sins so that we can be forgiven and given a new life. Lord, thank you for all those who are watching online. I pray that you continue to work in their lives. Help them to trust you during this difficult time. And Lord, always help us remember that you will never leave us. You will never walk out on us. That we can trust you. And like the scripture says, when we trust you, we will never be disappointed. And so, Lord, thank you for who you are, what you're going to do in our life. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. I got a couple of announcements. Tonight, we're starting something we're pretty excited about at 6 o'clock. You can come online and you can check it out. We're going to be putting up these devotionals all this week. Pastor Scott Simmons is going to be leading these 7 to 10 minute devotionals. They're going online starting tonight at 6, and we're going to have one of those all the way up until Friday. And on Friday, we're having our Good Friday service here at 6 o'clock, so we want to encourage you to join us for that. And then on Easter Sunday, we're going to be having our drive-in service. Hopefully that's going to continue to work out. We're going to see what the government has to say about it this week. But we want you to know that we are ready to celebrate Easter. Easter is not shut down. The church is not shut down. The church is not a building. The church is the people. And so I want to encourage you, wherever you're at, to get ready to celebrate with us Good Friday and Easter Sunday coming up. Some people have asked me, you know, Pastor, we haven't been around. How do we tithe? How do we do all that? And I just want to say there's three ways that you can give to support this ministry. We never ask people who aren't members of our church to give. So if you're not a member, this is not for you. But for those who want to continue to support us, three ways. Number one, you can mail it to our church address, your tithe. Secondly, you can drop it off in the mail slot in the door. And then thirdly, you can go on Venmo and connect with us, and then you can send your tithe that way. Guys, I hope you enjoy the service. We want you to know we love you. We're excited that everything God is doing, even in the midst of all this mess. Be praying for those that you love. Be praying for those who are on the other side of the world. We need God's followers to be in prayer during this time. And so let me just challenge you to pray. I love you. I cannot wait to see you again. And God bless you guys. We hope you have a wonderful week as we move towards Sunday. God bless you.